Mission given to me by Woody Shaw, Sonship, Dizzy, and John Kahn. Dedicated to pursuing a piece of our cultural heritage through interviews with my music heroes, this is The Jake Feinberg Show. Welcome inside the Parisi Palace, high above 2919 East Broadway. This is a special edition of the Jake Feinberg Show, coming to you live on Power Talk. Please go to our website, powertalk.live, download our free app. You can download it to your smartphone. Everyone's got one these days. And stream all of our live local programming, including Solomon on Blast and the Jake Feinberg Show. And we thank you for making us part of your day today. Without further ado, I want to bring in a cat that, I mean, in all due respect, stepping back after 5 years of doing my program and interviewing so many cats, when you find something in a thrift store like this record and it turns you on your head and it turns your daughters on their head and it gets you to dance with them like you've never heard before, and you look at this guy and say, boy, you know, I wonder if this cat's still out there. Not only is he still out there, his constant creation has never ceased. He's out there with John Batdorf woodshedding, among other things, Albert Lee. Three's a charm. James Lee Stanley, welcome to the Jake Feinberg Show.
Jake, I cannot believe you found that LP, man. That's so funny.
Let me tell you something, man. And then I went into another, our main record store in Tucson, and I found four more albums.
Yeah, I think I have 31 out.
I got to tell you, man, I'm not, and we'll get into it later, but this side B of this Three's the Charm is, I hear all these modern day cats, not Lenny Kravitz, but there was another cat who did a children's album. I don't know, just, this was 1973.
It's true, and you know who's on that, you know, in that band? The great Jimmy Haskell did the horns for it. Michael O'Mardian played keyboards. Russ Kunkel played the drums. Larry Carlton is doing the lead guitar, and Stephen Bishop and I are doing the background vocals.
Well, I want to tell you something. So I've interviewed a bunch of those cats, and I wanted you to one of the cats that flies below the radar because he went off, unfortunately, in my mind, there was nothing hotter than early 70s Christian rock because, quite frankly, they were bringing in cats who were non-denominational. As that moved along, you had to be in the boy. You had to be in the club if you wanted to do a Christian record, which I don't really necessarily agree with. But one of the cats who I've interviewed, I cannot wait to do part two with him. But he's a badass. and he played on a lot of your records, was Michael Omardian. Can you talk about...
Michael and I were friends. I actually used to stay with Michael when I lived in Santa Cruz, when come to Los Angeles trying to get a deal. I stayed with Michael, and I think he played keyboard on my... Yeah, it was John Jarvis on the first album. So Michael played on the third album, and he was a very good friend and a wonderful man, and for those of you who care, he's always been in the fold, you know. He was a Christian man.
Well, you know? I mean, and you know, I don't doubt that. I'm not doubting that. It's just the stuff that he was doing as a leader, and the what he brings to. He playing like an ARP synth on this album. This is James. This, I mean, can you put me in your head at the time of this album? Because to me, I hear there's a little bit of commerciality in the sense there's a little bit of Loggins Musina. I understand they brought in Kunkel because of the James Taylor effect. But
actually, I knew Russell before the James Taylor thing, and Russell played on all three of my albums, the first three albums for RCA. And I met him through a college friend, Leah Kunkel, who was the sister of Cass Elliott, who was the first person that ever paid for a recording session for me in Hollywood.
Oh, Mike, I cannot believe, dude, I already, James Lee Stanley is just enlightening everybody worldwide here. So Leah Kunkel.
Yeah, a great singer and a great songwriter and a great friend. I met her in college, and it's funny, I sat next to her, and I kept looking at her and thinking, you know, she's pretty, but she sure looks familiar. And when I finally got to talking, and I discovered that she was Cass's sister, and I said, you know, I've known Cass since, I met Cass when she was in the Big Three, which was a folk group way before the Mamas and Papas, you know.
Wait a minute, you got to go way back.
I think, maybe just turned 16, and I was working with a false ID in a nightclub because I wanted to be near the music, and I worked. I mean, I was there every night. I worked there 7 nights a week, and the people that I met, I'm still friends with. There was a band called the Modern Folk Quartet that had Jerry Yester in it, and Cyrus Faryar, and his name was Tad Dills then, but it was Henry Dills, and Chip Douglas. Now, Chip Douglas went on to produce all the Monkees records. Tad went on to become Henry Dills, the world-famous rock photographer who's done all the albums, every classic album of the 70s, you'll find Henry's pictures in there. And Jerry Yester, his brother, started the association. And Cyrus has been involved with everybody from Fred Neil to John Sebastian. I mean, all those guys. You know, I met them all then, you know, when... And Cass Elliott, Dennis Doherty came with a band called the Halifax Three, and the guitar player was Zalianowski, who became the guitar player in Love and Spoonful. Anyhow, I was involved with all those people, and I was only 16. And then when I finally came to Hollywood, because I joined the Air Force and did my time, and I did that so I could go to college. And then I came back from the Air Force, went to college in L.A., and ran into Leah. Then I reconnected with Cass, who took me into the studio, and I reconnected with Peter Tork. I had a nightclub in Virginia when I was 17 in high school because there's no place to play, so I started a club, became really famous. Emmylou Harris played there. Lots of people played there. But in any event, the first person I brought down was a guy I had sung with in Virginia Beach named Peter Tork, who was backing up. He was playing banjo behind some folk group. And I hired him because he was just really funny and you know, great on stage and knew a bunch of stuff. And we sang together some, and then we ended up being good friends. And I did three albums with him. First, I produced his solo album, and then he and I did three duet albums together and have toured, you know, sporadically through the years just for the fun of it.
Well,
okay. But I've always been involved with those people, and I've never stopped making albums. I just put out my 31st album, which is called Alive at Last.
Well, James. So, did Leah was Leah married to Russ at that point, or was that
correct? Leah told me that I think Russell was in a band called Things to Come, and she said, "You have to meet my husband. He's a great drummer." And so I met him, and he was a great guy, and we became friends. And then one day he came over, and he said, "James," he had an acetate with him, and he said, "You have to hear this, man." He said, "I just played on this record, and he said, "I think it's so good, but I, you know. What do you think?" And we put it on the player, And I said, wow. I said, I got to tell you, Russell, I think it's completely great. It might be so great that this pop audience won't even notice it, but I think it's great. But I actually thought that it was too good to catch on. And it was Sweet Baby James, and it caught on.
Wow. You know? No, because, I mean, I want you, Russell, we did a Cosmic hour-long interview a couple years ago on my show, and, he's really, I wanted you to talk about his strengths. Is it his ability to play a shuffle? Is it his ability to hold things down? To me, it's like you could be playing, on side B of this, Three's the Charm, which is by far one of the, I mean, this album holds up better today than it did in 1973.
I have to tell you one thing about it. When that album came out, there was a magazine called Billboard that was a big music magazine,
sure,
Billboard and Cashbox.
Sure.
And Billboard chose what they called spotlight albums, and they spotlighted Loggins and Messina. They spotlighted Queen. They spotlighted Alvin Lee with 10 Years After, and they spotlighted that album as four albums they thought were going to break out and become monsters.
Well, I'm telling you that at least those cats that were doing the journalistic work or whatever you want to call that, hyping up albums, at least they understood what was hip, because this, I can't even get to side A. I can't even turn the thing over. I just keep playing it over and over and over again. I called Batdorf yesterday.
And, oh, really?
Oh, yeah. I mean, listen, man, we've been long lost brothers that just haven't connected in 5 years. I mean, I was born in 78, well after your career was underway. But I have been on a mission to find the authentic cats that really came of age woodshedding on the bandstand. You know, again, you talk about these things, not matter of fact way, but the idea that at 17 you owned or you ran a nightclub. I mean, that's unheard of today.
I guess it is. I was pretty precocious, you know?
Well, I mean, you got Herb Albert just opened the nightclub, but after 50 years of woodshedding and becoming a millionaire,
uh-huh.
He's got some street cred, but I mean, you were 17, and the amount of cats that either were already playing professionally, the jazzers especially, from 13, 14, 15 years old.
Yeah, you really start. I mean, if it's your calling, man, you can't even resist it. It's almost like falling off a cliff. Once you fall, you can't reverse the.
Well, I think what I want to get your opinion on is the idea that it's true if it's in your blood and it's your passion, it's your true nature. But how concerned are you that younger cats? I mean, you had a propensity of live venues to play at for.
No, man, it was unbelievable, and I have to tell you that I also was. I had the benefit. I'm a very entertaining live performer, so I've always gotten a lot of work because I know what to do with an audience. But I know what to do with an audience because I learned in the spotlight. There used to be not only, I mean, there were so many clubs, and I opened, I was the opening act for everybody you can imagine, frequently the unannounced opening act. So I had to learn how to take this crowd and turn them into a responding audience.
How'd you do that? Talk about it.
I just tried to be as real as I could be. That's pretty big. Plus the fact that, although you can't tell it from this interview, I'm actually a funny guy on stage. I just know what tickles them. I know how to make them laugh. And the first thing I do is walk out there and talk to them a little bit and make them comfortable. And then I've been blessed with a really wonderful voice. I've been doing this, for 55 years, and I still sing. I sing better than I ever have. It's mysterious, actually. I just go out there and try to be as real as I can be. And
what is that? But I mean, to go
work without.
Yeah, to go deeper. What is that? Can you give us a concrete example of, especially earlier in your career when you didn't have total trust in who you were, still searching for your voice, when you took a chance on being yourself or being real, authentic, and that it paid off? Can you give a specific example to the audience?
Sure. I remember opening for Blood, Sweat, and Tears, which is a big horn band.
David Clayton.
David Clayton Thomas, right. And when the DJ who was hosting the show said to me, how do you want to be introduced? And I said, well, Because I'm out there playing with one guitar, what I would appreciate is if you didn't really jack the crowd up about Blood, Sweat, and Tears and then bring me out, because it will be a letdown.
Right.
And he said, okay, no problem. So he walked out there and he said, are you ready for Blood, Sweat, and Tears? Are you ready for the greatest horn band in the world? And he did this for like 5 minutes until they were in a frenzy. And then he said, but first, here's a folk singer from California.
Little old folk singer, out, yeah.
I walked out to a hail of boos and screaming and you know, cups of Coke flying at the stage, and they're yelling, we hate you, we hate you, and I haven't gotten to the microphone yet, you know.
Geez.
And so this is an example of being real.
Yeah.
I realized that they hated me, you know, and so I said to them, wow, what a bunch of candy asses. and they started getting quiet, and I said, you call that a boo? I'm from California. When we don't like somebody, we let them know it. I said, so here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to count to three, and then I want you to give me, you know, a respectable boo, not this candy-ass boo you're doing.
I love it.
So I counted to three, and they booed, and I said, nope, not good enough. Let's do it again. I made them do it three times, and the third time they booed, you know, they shredded their vocal cords booing me, and then they started laughing, and then they applauded, and then I did my show.
Who was your... were you up there solo acoustic, and then they were going to bring it? Then they were going to
one guitar, one voice, one guy.
So the idea that this the studio band that cut three is a charm. It wasn't like you were out gigging live with a band.
Not ever.
You've always worked in singer duos with acoustic guitars. Never any type of quintet or quartet.
No, I let's see. I did the two albums with John, those All Wooden Stones records, which I'm sure he talked about. And I did All Wooden Doors with Cliff Eberhardt. And I did the three duet albums with Peter. So that's like three, so that's six albums. But the other 25 albums I've done are solo albums. While I sometimes bring a band in, sometimes I'll play every single instrument on the album, and sometimes I'll just bring in percussion and bass, you know. And sometimes I'll just make an acoustic album where it's just me and the guitar. I do whatever serves the songs. You know what I mean?
Well,
and then when
I just know
one of the things that I've done, Jake, is I've studied a lot of records. And what I do with one guitar is, rather than just strum and sing or finger pick and sing, I do a guitar orchestration so that you can hear the whole arrangement regardless of how many people are up there with me.
Could you go back? Well, my question that I was trying to ask before was that, like, there are the one reason that I believe that when we're living through an incredibly formulaic time on the spectrum of music is just the fact that you can't play at upholstered sewers for two or three weeks at a time. I mean, how do younger cats be resourceful and creative and entrepreneurial when you don't have the opportunities to get comfortable finding your voice?
I have to tell you that's a great question, and it's something that's troubled me as I've watched the venues disappear. You know, with the advent of television in every home and computers in every home and the internet, there's so many avenues of entertainment that don't require getting up off of your butt.
Mm-hmm.
That a lot of these clubs have disappeared, and also the economy has changed so that, you know. It used to be that you could afford to go out on the road and find an audience. Now, I mean, if I want to fly, for instance, to Baltimore and play a gig, I'm looking, first of all, at a $500 airline ticket. And then I'm looking at probably another $500 to rent a car for a week. And then I have to stay in a hotel and eat, so I've got to charge a lot, which means the clubs have to charge a lot, which means even less people can go. You know, so it's definitely a problem. And one of the things that has ameliorated it, I believe, is the explosion of house concerts in America. Are you aware of this phenomenon?
Well, I mean, I've been to some. I can't say that they have any kind of truly transcendent experience the way Kunkel used to have watching Mahavishnu Orchestra when he went on tour with them and McLaughlin.
Right.
You know, he's getting the whole crowd quiet. But, yeah, I mean, I did.
I mean, you're talking about young people beginning, so, I mean, they're not going to begin by touring with the Mahavishnu.
No, but I guarantee you that you – I mean, I'm asking you to go into the memory bag, but, I mean, Sunset Boulevard alone had the Sea Witch. I mean, there were dozens and dozens and dozens of clubs that...
Oh, you know, that's where they all... I mean, sure, that's and that's the only place you're going to get good is in front of an audience.
Exactly.
So, I mean, I think they have a real problem now. A lot of people will go and they'll make a video and they'll put it on YouTube, and if it catches on, if it goes viral, they get famous, and then they walk into that spotlight and they know nothing about how to entertain, and the audience is enormously unforgiving. You know, and they can't wait to forget you. You go out there and blow it, they're going to go, nope, not interested in that person. And then you have a really hard time ever doing it again.
James Lee Stanley here on the Jake Feinberg Show. But, James, here's the other problem, and this is a little bit more duplicitous. It bothers me, and I want to also get, this dovetails with our lack of venues, and people can't authentically develop their own voices, is that now you have situations where, like you said, it's, you talked about a viral video, but I'm more in the idea of saying some girl who's beautiful, has 30,000 Twitter followers, comes into the studio, sings. She says, how do I sound? The engineer says, terrible, we can fix it. Meaning that all of a sudden now you're having people that are quote unquote stars that really have no musical ability at all.
And so, you know what? I'm not going to mention any names, but I have played with some really, really famous people who, it turns out, needed all that studio help to do it. That they had a machine called Auto-Tune that was tuning them live on the stage because they couldn't do it.
Really?
You know, when you know what? When the music business became so lucrative is when a lot of people came into it for all the wrong reasons. When I got into the music business, there weren't any rich musicians except maybe Frank Sinatra. You know, musicians played, and you had a successful life if you actually got to play music your whole life, which I have done. You know, I have toured with everybody and played live for 50 years and been so blessed, you know, so lucky. And I don't know. I've lost my thread there.
No, I want to go back to this. But now with the idea that, okay, you obviously have been on the bandstand for 4 or 5 decades now. You know, the advent of technology, though, has clearly made it different to determine whether somebody actually has true musical chops.
Well, it's invalidated. It's devalued the currency of an album. It used to be that there were gatekeepers. There were all these guys they called A&R people at record labels, and you would go in and audition for them or send them tapes and make demo after demo to try to get a record deal. And when you finally got good enough, you got through the door, you know? Now, anybody with a computer and GarageBand can make an album. So the marketplace, the radio stations are completely flooded with CDs that people are making, and many of them should have perhaps done some woodshedding. You know, they still have open mics, and they really are helpful if you take advantage of them. When you go in there to play an open mic, you pick your best stuff because you're only going to have like 5 minutes or 10 minutes, you know. And to have to be good in that time frame, it helps you focus everything. It helps you trim away all the dead wood and get to the real meat of what you do, you know. And all I can say is that you have to play every place you can possibly play. I certainly did. I mean, I played shoe stores. I played, you know, farmers markets. I played craft fairs. I played bars. I played, you know, and lots of times they don't give you any money to do that. And I did it anyhow. You know, I just played no matter what.
Just going back to Russ.
I mean, that will filter out the people that can't sing. We'll get the feedback immediately that perhaps this isn't their gift, you know?
Yeah, no, I dig. I go back to Omardian, and you know, I mean, again, they had Steely Dan had $500,000 budget. Cats were in there daily trying to work out grooves.
I know amazing stories about Steely Dan records.
I've interviewed Steve. I've interviewed all the cats. I mean, I know Steve Gadd. You know, Harvey Mason walked out of the studio during Asia. They tried 50 drummers. It's just,
yeah.
It was like it was a kid in the candy store. So, I mean, you know, you...
Now that's gone. There's no budgets like that anymore. Except for maybe Taylor Swift or something. But.
Well, yeah, I mean, and that's, you know, that's not stuff that's in my rotation. I wanted to go back to Kunkel for a minute because I'm going through this...
Yeah, you asked what it was about Kunkel.
Well, you know, I've interviewed so many. I mean, everyone from Bernard Pretty Purdy to all the psychedelic drummers of the Bay Area. Every single drummer from your generation, my friend, had their own individual sound. When I interviewed Bill Cosby for the first time, he talked about being able to put on a blindfold. You could throw a record on. He could tell you if it was Pete LaRocca or Mickey Roker or Elvin Jones. Every single freaking dude had their own individual sound. And
yeah,
now,
they did.
And now you can't tell the difference between anybody, okay? So, everyone's comping and there's no stretching of the vocabulary. But speaking about Kunkel, talk about what made him a special drummer.
Well, I can tell you that the first thing that happens is that when Russell came to the studio is that he has a lot of confidence, you know, so you feel like you're in good hands, and he's very personable. He always made me feel good about my music. He made me feel like I was somebody special, and that he was delighted to come and help. And he also, I must tell you, worked for less than scale for me because he liked my music, you know. But the point is that he made you feel good, and by virtue of his level of playing, he made you play better. You know, I didn't know that I rushed at all until, because you play by yourself, you don't have that metronome, you tend to float time-wise.
Sure.
Russell, the first person, said, you know what, James, I think you're getting ahead of the beat. And I thought, ahead of the beat? What's that? And he said, here, let me show you, man. He said, look, this is the back of one. This is right on one. This is a little on top of one. You see the difference? And he played me, and I went, oh, yeah. And it was the first time I realized that even though there was one, two, three, four, there was also, you know, the front of one, the back of one, right on one, and that all those things change the feel of a song. And also his natural... His natural feel is, you know, just really good. I also had Jim Gordon, who was on Layla. You know, I mean, he played on my first and second album, and he was the same way, easy to get along with, and could play anything. And if you said that doesn't feel right, he'd go, how about this? He didn't have any ego attached to it. All he was trying to do was serve the tunes, and that's what Russell does. Russell serves a song, you know.
Do you look at younger cats like myself in the 30s, 20s, you know, we have been, for lack of a better word, I mean, we are extremely creative, very dynamic, very emotional, very sensitive. But in terms of music, you talk to the masters of music or anybody who played with the original masters, that they knew the music itself was always above any one individual person. And I wonder,
yeah.
I wonder if you, I mean, you talk about serving the music. I mean, has that value shift changed where you look at people, you just mentioned Taylor Swift or Snoop Dogg or any of these guys, they're always at the front and the accompanists are always in the back. You know, have you noticed a shift in the idea that somehow one person now is above the music? The ego has become bigger than the actual musical.
Well, it's just that you're talking about the pop market. And I mean, you know, if you go into anybody that devotes their life to music, they really commits to it, they're not going to have that kind of situation because it's going to be one of give and take. I mean, you go see I took my wife to see Miles Davis, and while Miles was certainly Miles Davis, you know, he intermingled with the band in a million different ways, you know, physically and mentally and verbally and you know, when you stand out in front of them, it's just when they make these pop stars, they're trying to make a brand. They're selling ketchup, you know? So they stick the ketchup bottle right up there in the front. That's all. It doesn't have a lot to do with music. It has more to do with making a brand that you can sell and make a lot of money. And I certainly am not condemning, you know, becoming financially successful. I'm just saying that the main thrust of those people is not the music. It's the brand. That's all.
Can you talk about this experience with Miles? I mean, you're talking about one of the most interesting nonverbal leaders around. How did he communicate with the band? This is a guy who used to hold up signs for people. He would not even announce their names.
Yes, when someone would play a solo, right. He'd walk to the drum riser and pick up a piece of cardboard that was like 3 feet by 2 feet, and on that piece of cardboard printed so that anybody could read it, no matter if they were in the nosebleed section, and it would be the name of that particular player.
Exactly.
And he would play a solo, and he'd look over at somebody and nod, and they'd take off, when they finished, he'd give them another nod, you know, and rarely smiled, but always, you sense the approval, you know. He was quite the taskmaster, and I understand that in the studio, he was much more verbal. Matter of fact, I have a wonderful cassette of Miles in the studio doing Kind of Blue. And he does a lot of talking in that. Yeah, Teo, I think we need some more, you know. Teo Becerra was his producer.
Sure.
And I even have a book called The Making of Kind of Blue. That's one of my favorite records of all time. I mostly listen to jazz because I want to hear people that play better than I do, and I want to learn and grow, you know. That's one of the things is that I feel like as a true musician, our responsibility is to always try to be better than we were, with the full knowledge that we'll never get to where we want to be. It's that old joke, every time you think you're on top of it all, they move it. That is, in fact, an artist's life. No matter where they are, there's always a faster gun. There's always somebody that's doing something where you go, wow. And then you go back to the woodshed, you know, because you want to do that too.
Well, you're going to have to unfriend some people on Facebook because I tried to friend you yesterday, but you've exceeded the limit, and I disseminate.
Well, you know what, Jake? Because I'm so advanced in my in my years,
yeah.
I can tell you that frequently friends are leaving the planet. So just wait a day or two.
No, you know what? All I'm going to say is that a lot of the story, what I've done on my show is that I recognize that people are not always either going to listen in live or even. Stream the interview in an audio fashion once it goes up on my website. So I take these stories, like the one that you just wax poetic about this, the life of a musician. I'll throw that up on Facebook with a picture of you, and that will get shared 50 times and viewed thousands. I disseminate a lot of this information through. I just want to give you a heads up that I scouted you out yesterday, but you have reached the maximum limit. So we'll see
that I posted your link, by the way.
I didn't check it out. I want to know. Okay, so, digitalis. Okay, we have necrophilia, hemophilia, delirium, menopause. I mean,
I can explain.
I want you to talk. This to me, this is the great. I posted this the other week to a friend of mine who's in a kind of a. They're in a bit of a holding pattern, but they have this kind of groove, melodic. World band, and the lead singer kind of one of the things that I think they need to grow in is that the lead singer has a really hard time speaking with words. It's mainly in just sort of chopped up syllables or partial words, and it's a little bit hard to understand, but I hear this and the groove is so hypnotic, and then the lyrics are like, I'm like, James Lee Stanley was just, I mean, there must have been just copious amounts of LSD. Please take me through it.
Okay, you know what? It actually was a little bit more mundane than that. After I made my second album, the people at RCA called a meeting, and I went in there, and they said, you know, James, we really like what you're doing, but why don't you write a hit? And I'm not kidding. And I went, write a hit? I said, gee, what a good idea. I don't know why I didn't think of that. You know?
Just do it, man. Just do it.
You know? In any event, I said, sure, what kind of hit you want? And the guy looks at me and he says, well, you know, we don't have anybody in the stable. That's what they call the stable of artists. We don't have anybody in the stable to compete with Carlos Santana. You know, and I looked at him. I'm thinking, one little white boy with acoustic guitar, and you're telling me that I need to be
electric power rock, yeah, you know.
Power rock band, you know. And I said, sure, no problem. So I went home, and I just took that groove from Evil Ways by Carlos, and I started playing it, and then I realized that I didn't speak a word of Spanish. But I thought, well, you know, Spanish is derived from Latin. What if I just used Latin words? And then it became just a goof, and I went through and I picked every Latin word that would be fun, like pellagra and hemophilia and onanism, which is, of course, self-abuse. And, I mean, I just I chose every peculiar word I could find.
I mean, it is so freaking hip. I strung
together so that it rhymed and sang it like a Latin boogie hit, and they came in and I said, I want this to be just like Carlos Santana. I don't think they're gonna notice that the words are in fact Latin medical terms, you know. So it was just a great fun thing to do.
This is why I do my show, to get to the bottom of this. We have a game on this program. I think you're gonna be right on it. We have a game on this program called Name That Tune. Let's take a listen. Mm-hmm. Let's take a listen to this music and then we'll come back and break it down.
Okay.
On the Jake Feinberg Show, brought to you by the Circle Tree Ranch, Abbott Taylor Jewelers, the Stereo Hospital, the Jewish Federation of Southern Arizona, the Jewish Community Center, and Craig Pretzinger of Allstate Insurance, and we thank them for their support so we can play tunes like that for James Lee Stanley. What do you got for us, my man?
That particular tune was inspired by just the idea that we all go around looking for, answers in life, and I thought, what if we're just supposed to be here and be as good as we can be, and the puzzle is lying when they say there's answers. There aren't any answers. You be the best person you know how to be. That's the answer. So that was the start of it, and then I decided I wanted to make it a choral piece, and after I think I did about 12 tracks of vocals myself, and then I wanted a different texture change, so I brought Stephen Bishop in a little bit later to play some stuff. And then the end of it, there's a real long fade on that particular cut, and I gave it to Michael, and I said, Michael, I want it to sound like a kitten got lost on the keyboard up at the high end. And so that's what
I love this.
At the end, it just came together great. It was just a nice piece. Nice choral piece.
The bridge on that. Did that come last? I mean, to me, it seems like those are the hooks. These songs that you were just right on the pulse of it. How did you come up with that bridge?
I was looking for. I started with the first part. Da 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 da. That round and round thing. I wanted it to be around, and then I thought I need some release from this. And one of the things that I learned from listening, from actually absorbing the Beatle records, was that they always had a spectacular release from what they were doing. They always went someplace else, kind of fresh thing that was just not like anything else. And then that miraculously led back into what you already knew. And so I was simply trying to do something like that. I wanted to go someplace else from that nice little da-da-da thing and then go back in there. So I added the blues chords in that section, because otherwise it's all sixes and nines. It's all like Debussy or Ravel. But then in that section, I added sevens like you add in blues music, you know, flat sevens. And
Were you the type of cat who was going to Shelley's Manhole? I mean, we're going to see a lot of live jazz. When you said you were into jazz, can you?
I went to see everything, man. I discovered that. As an example, I thought I didn't like bluegrass, but I toured with Emmylou Harris and Ricky Skaggs, and I discovered that no, actually, what I don't like is bad bluegrass.
Right.
I mean, in fact, if you go to any genre and find the masters in it, it's going to be rewarding. It's going to be fulfilling, no matter what it is, you know. And that's what I tried to do. I just kept looking to be thrilled musically, you know. And it didn't matter what genre. So I went to everything. I went to, you know, clubs and coffee houses and concert halls and Hollywood Bowl. Every place. Whatever place I could go. And plus, then it didn't cost. I mean, I went to the entire Monterey Pop Festival, all 3 days. It cost me $22.
I guess more specifically, I was curious as if you were like aware of the different changes in rhythm, you know, like for instance with Miles's band with Ron Carter and Tony Williams, the way they would break up the time and then come back into the time. I wanted you to talk about the live experience of seeing music when you were just beginning to get comfortable with your own voice and your own style, especially if you could point to a seminal moment when you saw some kind of melodic music that really kind of had an impact on you, and why.
Sure. If I can just do one fast digression, Tony Williams and I were managed by the same guy for a while.
Jesus, are you serious?
Yeah, and I mean, I couldn't get his attention a lot, but I did get to meet Tony and talk to him, and when I met him, under his arm were some textbooks, and I said, "What's that?" And he said, "Oh, it's I'm taking lessons." And I thought, one of the greatest drummers in the world,
yeah,
is taking lessons. You know, I mean, it made me realize that that the real guys are they keep trying to learn, they keep trying to get better. You know, it was really inspirational to me. And in terms of, I think the first time that somebody vocally blew my socks off, I think it was the Modern Folk Quartet, which was, they were doing like high-lows kind of arrangements of folk songs. So there was all these sounds that I just wasn't familiar with, and I was thrilled by it. And the group that came the next week was the Big Three. And when I heard Cass, you know, just do this contralto that was so vibrant and resonant, I just knew that's what I wanted to do, you know?
So you knew Mama Cass can you talk about the band she was in prior to the Mamas and Papas?
She was in a band called the Big Three. It was a folk band with Tim Rose and a guy named James Hendricks. And the three of them did all those traditional folk songs, except that when Cass sang them, you know, they were elevated into some other realm, you know. And she had such an amazing presence on stage. And I also like the fact that she didn't you know, like apologize for not looking like a model, a Vogue model. She was herself back when that was enormously courageous. You know?
Absolutely. So when Leia found you, her career had already been going on for a while.
Oh, Cass's? Oh, absolutely.
No, well, no, I mean, Leia was also in that band as well?
Leia Kunkel?
Yeah.
No, no. I met Leia after the Air Force, after the club, and after high school, after the Air Force. And when I came back from Taiwan, where I was a Chinese linguist, after that, I went to college on the GI Bill, and Leah was in one of my orchestration and arranging classes, and that's where I met her.
Ni hao, wo jiao.
She had no wo han tao ni na.
No, wo jiao jie ke. My wife is Taiwanese, man.
Oh wow,
dude, that is so I knew the spirit. See, this is the way my life has been, and you have to realize, like, my daughters are listening obsessively now to James Lee Stanley. This is unbelievable. How did you get your chops up in Chinese language back in the 60s? How the heck did that happen?
Oh, it was easy. I had absolutely no choice.
Why is that?
I was in the Air Force, and they did these screening tests. And the next thing I know, I was at the Defense Language Institute in Monterey studying Chinese, which we did for, about 6 months, highly intensive, you know, no English. I remember the first day we went in there, Dr. Tharp told us that he said, the next English words you hear will be the last English words.
You welcome to the class. That's the way you got to do it. So, I'm where were you? Were you in Kaohsiung? Where were you in Taiwan?
No, I was in Taichung, which is in the center.
Taichung.
Yeah.
So you were in the center. Did you? I mean, my wife is from a small fishing town in the south called Donggang,
and I've never been there. I didn't get to go to that area.
What was the? So were you dabbling at all with music at all at that point? Were you playing at all?
I wrote while I was there. I wrote. Let's see. I was there for 15 months, and I wrote one song a week. And demoed it on my little wall. Well, it wasn't a Wallensack. It was an Akai tape recorder. I did that, one song a week for the whole time I was there.
And then eventually that got onto a record or something?
One or two of them finally made it onto a record years later after I rewrote them even again. But, you know, you just have to keep writing. And I mean, for every album that I've done, and I've done 31 albums, where I wrote almost all the songs, with the exception of that, you know, when I did the Stones thing or the Doors thing, you know. Other than that, I wrote all the songs. And usually, for every album of 10 songs, I've probably written 50 and then gone, this isn't quite right yet, you know.
No, the Round and Round song, the guy I was thinking of before was Jack Johnson. And
the Hawaiian guy. Yeah. Guy from Hawaii.
That dude, he did when my first daughter was born, he did a children's album that we used to listen to. And as far as I'm concerned, that tune that you just did was better than anything off that album that as a children's tune. You know, part of my show is one of the L's in my program is life. And when I speak about life, it means overcoming adversity, overcoming challenges. And because I think in today's world, a lot of people can get psyched out and quit before they start. Or give up before they really should. And I was hoping you could talk about a time in your career where you were fighting it in your life. Could be anything. Could have been music, personal, whatever. And
oh, sure.
How you overcame it and how it made you stronger.
Yeah, I can tell you that about the year 2000, I was just getting very discouraged. It seemed like no matter what I did, I couldn't, you know, get any real radio support. And I'm a good performer, so I keep getting work, you know, even though I get not too much help from the media, you know.
Sure.
And I was just getting discouraged, and I took my guitar in to get it fixed, and they told me that it was going to cost me, you know, $700 to get the guitar fixed. And I said, well, it was the only guitar I had, and it was a $400 Washburn guitar that I bought after my Martins were stolen from me in New York City, and so. I thought, I'm not going to pay $700 to fix a $400 guitar. And I thought, you know what? No one cares what I'm doing anyhow. I'm just going to play this old crappy guitar. And when the work dries up, that'll be the end of it. That's it. You know, when the guitar breaks. I mean, I was just right at the nadir, you know.
Hmm.
And then this journalist here in Los Angeles called me up and said, James, I'm putting together a Dylan Fest. Would you like to be part of that? I said, well, what do I have to do? He said, just learn a couple of Dylan songs. I said, okay. So I went in, I sat down, and I completely rearranged two Bob Dylan songs so that it sounded essentially like I wrote them. And I learned them, and I wrote these guitar parts for them, and then I went to do the show. Well, when I got to the show, there was about 15 or 16 artists on the show, and most of them had simply taken the lyrics from the Dylan song, put them on a piece of paper that they taped to the microphone stand and just sang them the way Dylan did it, you know? And I did complete reinventions of the Dylan songs, and the people flipped out. I got like a standing ovation, and I thought, wow, maybe maybe it's not over yet. You know? And then, listen to this. So the next day I get on a plane and I fly to Chicago to play the clubs where I still have some constituency. And there's a guy sitting on the bus as we're going to the rental cars, and he says, you musician, huh? And I said, yeah. I said, did the guitar case give it away? And he said, what have you got in there? And I said, I have a Washburn. He said, you should be playing a Taylor. And I said, well, then Taylor should give me a Taylor. And he said, well, I'm Bob Bourbonus, and I work for Taylor. And he said, what's your name? And I said, James Lee Stanley. And he said, I know who you are.
Wow.
You should play a Taylor guitar. He said, we will send one up to you. And I thought, what? I mean, I literally thought nobody knew I was even on the planet. And here's this Taylor guitar offering to, you know, send me a guitar if I would just play it, you know. And I thought, wow. Maybe it isn't over.
Well, okay, so can you, for people that are just tuning in or have been followed, what does that overarching theme mean to you? What does it mean to you? Can you talk about the macro?
It's really simple. You know, you don't lose the war till you give up. You know, it isn't over until you quit. And I've just never quit. Never.
Right.
You know, no matter what happens. I write songs and I tour and I make another album by hook or by crook and I get it out there and I tour some more, and if they don't embrace it, I make another one. You know, one of the things, I mean, I listen to a lot of music and I actually at this stage in my life am convinced that I'm very good at this. I mean, I'm sorry that you know, the world hasn't doesn't agree with me, but it hasn't at this stage of the game. It really doesn't alter my opinion of what I do, you know. You should afterwards give me your address and I'll send you the, you know.
I would love it, man. No, this is just the beginning of, I mean, this is, have you been back to Taiwan at all?
One other thing, I have not been back to Taiwan, yeah. But we're planning to do a reunion with the whole Chinese class and go back.
Oh, that's awesome.
But I have to tell you that the man that painted the cover of Three's the Charm is a wonderful artist named John Soli, who happens to live in Tucson, Arizona.
I need to get to that cat. No, hold on. No, but I want to, was this part of it is on the back. These lyrics are written out in incredible pencil.
That's me. I read.
Okay, I knew it. This is the. I have another album I just bought yesterday for $4. James Lee Stanley albums, for the audience out there, I cannot recommend. The guy has his finger on the pulse. You know, again, it needs to be. There needs to be validation of that, as there was on the bus in Chicago. But that is when did you also? You wrote this song Round and Round, saying maybe we're just here to do the best we can. Was there some kind of, that doesn't sort of just pop into everybody's mind, as opposed to like everything happening for a reason, or you're a chosen one and you're just saying, no, maybe we're just here because we're just trying to give our best effort. How did you come to that realization? Was there some kind of demarcation point?
Maybe it's because I was blessed with a really loving, nurturing family and parents who, you know, lived their lives just trying to make the lives of their children better than it was for them, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They were just really honorable people, and as I went through the world, I noticed that if dishonorable people, even when they win, don't win. You know, I just noticed it, that it wasn't, they weren't happy, that things don't make you happy, and that doing for others really does. It really does, you know?
Mm, I dig.
Just think about having a pet. You have a pet cat, for instance. What does that cat do for you? Does he type? Does he do your laundry? Does, you know what I mean? Does he guard the house? Nothing. But you take care of it, this cat, and you make its life sweet while it's here, and every time you touch that cat or see it, you feel good. Just because you did something that was essentially selfless, you know?
When are you in, tell me about the sonic nature of a Batdorf Lee Stanley concert.
It's two guitars, and we rehearse our brains out, and we write very intricate guitar arrangements of all the songs. It's so funny. I had been at a wedding and went on stage with two other songwriters, and we realized when we got up there, the band had taken a break, and people said, get up there and sing. So we went up there on stage, discovered that all three of us only knew the songs that we wrote ourselves. And so the guy in the middle, who happened to have a guitar, said, well, do you know Ruby Tuesday? And I said, I know the chorus. So he went into Ruby Tuesday with one acoustic guitar, and he's a good singer. His name is Rod McDonald, wonderful topical songwriter from Florida. In any event, when we got to the chorus, George Merrill, who was a fantastic harmony guy, he was in a band called Boy Meets Girl, and they had a song called Waiting for the Sky to Fall, big hit. And he also wrote How Will I Know for Whitney Houston. He's a great writer and singer. Anyhow, he took the high part. I took the low part. Rod sang the melody. And we did this three-part arrangement on the fly of Ruby Tuesday, and the wedding crowd went crazy. They loved it. And on the way home, I decided that I thought, no one's actually ever heard the Rolling Stones done by guys that actually sing. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And so I mean, God bless the Rolling Stones, but Mick isn't exactly a bel canto singer, you know? So I thought, what would happen if I took the Rolling Stones songs and I rearranged them as if Crosby, Stills, and Nash wrote them? So I called George and asked him to be a partner, and he said he would. And then he said, there's a guy in your neighborhood who's really good. His name is John Batdorf. And I said, Batdorf? I haven't seen him since Batdorf and Rodney in the early 70s when I used to tour with him.
Sure.
And so I called John. We got together. George bowed out, and Timothy Schmidt came on board. So it was going to be Timothy, John, and I. And then, this is so weird, Timothy came and did one song with us, and the next day he calls up, he goes, James, I just heard from Don Henley, he's putting the band back together. And I said, well, if the choice is between working on this album with me or going back with the Eagles, I say you go with the Eagles.
Right. Well, I mean...
So John and I did the whole thing. We just sat here in the studio, and we played, every Rolling Stones songs we could think of, and then we started moving them around, and the next thing you know, we come up with this sound that isn't like anything else. And the album, XM called that first All Wooden Stones record, they said, it's in contention for the record of the year. It's the best thing we had. They loved it. And then I ran into John Densmore, the drummer for The Doors.
I've interviewed Johnny.
And the first time I shook his hand and I said my name, he said, hey, I love that Stones thing you did. And I thought, what? So I sat down and we had lunch, and he said, listen, if you ever decide to do The Doors, I'll play on it. So I called John, and he said, I'm in this other project. I said, okay. So I called Cliff Eberhardt, and Cliff said, oh, man, I'd love to do it. So he flew out, and we did All Wooden Doors, which, and everybody played that way. Everybody on that record is famous except me, I think. Peter Tork's on there. Timothy Schmidt's on there. Paul Barrere from Little Feat's on there. Lawrence Duber from Wings. And also Robbie Krieger and John Densmore from The Doors are on that record.
So yeah, we have to do part two, James Lee. I it was such an honor to connect with you, man. And can I call you later, and I'll give you my address and everything, and ship that stuff.
You know what? I've got a gig in Tehachapi, which is about 3 hours from here. So
I'll give you a call tomorrow, maybe or
absolutely.
Next.
Call me tomorrow after like 10 a.m. and I'm your guy.
Love always, man. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jake. I sure appreciate it.
All right,
okay,
man. Bye bye. And we'll be right back with Seth Walker on The Jake Feinberg Show.